The world of Gucci is a crazy mix of murder, fashion, and Jared Leto. And with a script that fudges the details on a lot of key moments, you need a guide, aka a 14-ish minute YouTube video. You'll learn which method Lady Gaga used to get her act on, the shocking amount of Gucci products featured in the movie, and which character's real-life brain tumor was left on the cutting room floor. In the name of the Gaga, the Driver, and the House of Screen Rant, here's everything you missed from House of Gucci. Ridley Scott's House of Gucci is inspired by The House of Gucci, a sensational story of murder, madness, glamour, and greed by Sarah Gay Forden, a book that detailed the case of Gucci family member and executive Maurizio Gucci's murder by his ex-wife Patrizia Reggiani. So it's based on a true story, which, according to the Coen brothers, means absolutely nothing. When talking about Fargo, they said, "You don't have to have a true story to make a true story movie." Yeah. Okay. And by that they meant almost none of Fargo was true. So what about House of Gucci? Certainly not as bad as Fargo, but it did take a few liberties that end up making it a better movie. First of all, for a movie to work, we gotta like the protagonist, the hero of the movie, which is probably why they fudged the story of Maurizio Gucci's origin at the family business. In the film, Maurizio Gucci is disowned by his father and takes a job working for Patrizia's father's transportation business, which leads us to the bizarre water gun play fight between Maurizio and a coworker. And since they didn't release that much footage of the movie, here's a dramatization.
Brent!
Huh?
No!
Surprise, surprise, that never happened. In fact, Maurizio never worked for Patrizia's father's transportation business at all. Maurizio can't be the protagonist of the film and also a rich kid who never works a day in his life. He's gotta be relatable. So throw in some fake working class water fighting and he's golden. They also fudged Patrizia's story a bit too. In the film, she states that she worked for her father's business as an accountant, but this also is false. According to Patrizia, when offered a way to get out of jail sooner on a work release program, she said, "I've never worked a day in my life, I won't start now." So either she's embellishing, which is entirely possible, or she's telling the truth and the film needed her to work. At least a little. And that's not the only detail sacrificed on the altar of movie structure. In the film, Patrizia spends the first quarter trying to convince Maurizio to work for Gucci, but Maurizio preferred working for her dad's transportation company, which we know is false. So what really happened?
Patrizia didn't have to convince Maurizio to work for Gucci at all. In real life, Maurizio started working for Gucci of his own accord in 1972. This is another important screenwriting technique. A character can't just see an opportunity and take it. There must be a debate. So in the movie, we have a Maurizio who just wants to be a lawyer and is reluctant to start at the family business.
When in real life, he was very much ready to live the high life in New York and needed no convincing.
And this addition plays double duty, as it also lets Lady Gaga's character Patrizia flex a bit, as one of her character strengths is confidence and the will to get what she wants. So just this little tweak gives us insight into Patrizia and gives a lot more weight to Maurizio's decision to work at Gucci.
Okay, here's the thing I missed, because going into this movie, I didn't watch a trailer or even read anything about it. And the biggest thing that I missed was that Paolo was played by Jared Leto. Come on now, I had no idea.
After the fact, looking at those eyes, you can totally see it. But I had honestly no idea. And if anything, the guy playing Tom Ford looked more like Jared Leto than freaking Paolo.
Even Al Pacino had no idea it was Jared.
I showed up for the first day of work and character, and I went up and I said, "Papa, it's me, Paolo." And he basically shuffled off again. He's like, "Who's this creep?" And then someone whispered to him, "Al, it's Jared." And he turned around and he said, "Oh, my son,
my son!
Lady Gaga threw herself into the character of Patrizia Reggiani so much so that she committed to method acting, maintaining Reggiani's accent, frame of mind, and mannerisms for 9 months while filming.
Those of us that commit ourselves to method acting, that there's something about us that's just fully committing ourselves to the art on a cellular level.
Ah, method acting. It's that thing where actors stay in character on and off set, right? Well, not exactly.
Method acting started with actor and director Konstantin Stanislavski, and was later expanded on by Lee Strasberg, Stella Adler, and Sanford Meisner, three names that are now acting styles in and of themselves.
But method acting does not mean staying in character on and off screen. Depending on which method you lean towards, it's more about going through a script and feeling the emotions the character would feel through using your imagination or by thinking of experiences you've already had and connecting them to the words. But even Stanislavski himself abandoned the technique of staying in character on and off set because the results were never fully satisfactory.
Some other actors who chose to stay in character even while off set were acting titan Daniel Day-Lewis and funny man Jim Carrey, who was famously a huge asshole while on set for the Andy Kaufman biopic, Man on the Moon.
With Patrizia, it was much easier for me to stay in character all the time. When I called my mother, when I called my father, I wouldn't have pretended that I'm Patrizia. You just would have been like, "Oh, I'm on the phone with Patrizia."
Gaga suffered for her commitment to staying in character. She has said that she went through a very dark time while filming the movie, as staying in the mindset of a woman who put a hit out on her husband is not a great place to be. But one of the advantages of remaining in character 24/7 was that Gaga got very good at improvising dialogue, some of which made it into the final cut of the film. One of the more famous lines used in the trailer was actually a Lady Gaga original.
Father, son, and House of Gucci.
And the way Ridley Scott filmed scenes for House of Gucci made it perfect for improvisation. Movies are generally shot the same way, one camera per scene. That way, the lighting and sound only need to be perfect from one angle. Introduce multiple cameras, and you limit where lights can be placed and risk the mics being seen. But that didn't stop Ridley Scott from using multiple cameras, as much as 6 per scene. According to Adam Driver,
they become more invisible because there's so many, 5, 4 to 6. And so it feels like theater in the round, basically. You're not playing to any one camera, you're playing the scene. It makes you go on to other films and wonder why, you know,
they're not all done that way.
Exactly, that you're not moving that fast.
And given Ridley Scott's use of multiple camera angles, the actors are much more free to improvise anything, including getting a little Gucci between the sheets, if you know what I mean. Gaga's relationship with co-star Adam Driver on set was close enough that they felt comfortable improvising one of their early sex scenes. We blocked it out, as we would any fight or any scene, and then we just ran it maybe once or twice, and that was it. We were feeling it, so to speak. I will also say at that point, we had been shooting for a month, so we felt very comfortable to go where we needed to go. For those with no knowledge of the real-life events, they'd be surprised to find out that Patrizia and Maurizio had 2 children, not 1. In the film, we see the birth of Alessandra Gucci, but nowhere to be found is their second daughter, Allegra, who was born in 1981. This detail was changed probably just to streamline the script, as the movie is already 2.5 hours long. Adding another birth would just add too much to the runtime. Another large detail that was omitted from the script was Patrizia's brain tumor, which doctors found in 1992. She began suffering from very bad headaches and had surgery and radiation to get the tumor out. Fortunately, it turned out to be benign, but unfortunately, according to experts at trial, the unnecessary surgery and radiation damaged her brain, leading to an inability to use reason and judgment. This caused Patrizia's 2 daughters to side with her during her trial for the murder. But the court didn't totally buy it. According to the book, they did a detailed analysis of her personality, and they basically said that she had a narcissistic personality disorder. Patrizia had an exaggerated perspective and put herself at the center of things. She perceived things being done against her, so when Maurizio started to take, and then lose, control of the company, Patrizia felt like it was a slight against her personally. That was her personality and how she read things as happening in her world. And when she was on trial, according to the book, she danced around interrogations very well. There were times when she even appeared to be sharper than the prosecutor. Patrizia's daughter, Allegra, even went to law school to help her mom's defense, but after Patrizia was let out of prison, things turned sour. According to Patrizia, they don't understand me and have cut off my financial support. I have nothing, and I haven't even met my 2 grandsons.
Maybe don't murder their father? I don't know. I mean, I don't have kids, so I don't know.
Speaking of the real-life Patrizia, Gaga was fully committed to the part, but she broke with most actors who take on the task of playing a real person, in that she didn't meet the real-life Black Widow. According to Lady Gaga,
I did all the research on who she was as a person, but I didn't want to meet her because I could tell very quickly that this woman wanted to be glorified for this murder, and she wanted to be remembered as this criminal.
So you've never met her?
No, I didn't want to collude with something that I don't believe in.
For a film called House of Gucci, you'd think that every character would be decked out in Gucci from start to finish of the 2.5 hour runtime. But if you thought that, you'd be wrong. Janet Yates, the costume designer for the film, explained that Gucci in the 70s was mostly tweeds and browns, so it wasn't a big part of the movie. Patrizia liked Yves Saint Laurent, and Maurizio preferred suits from Savile Row, while Aldo Gucci enjoyed Zenga.
I personally prefer Target, but that's just me.
And most of the movie takes place before Tom Ford revolutionized Gucci as a fashion brand, when Gucci's focus was mostly luggage, shoes, scarves, and accessories. Yates also said that an important part of making the fashion authentic was the fact that they were able to move the entire Gucci archive to Los Angeles. Without the archive at their disposal, it would have been a lot harder to get authentic looks just based on photos and videos from the time. They also used the Gucci Museum, which had pictures and video footage of the showrooms and workrooms, which gave the production team greater insight into the process so the film could be more authentic. In another instance of heightening real-life events for the big screen, Paolo's launch of a fashion line was a bit of a little white lie. In real life, Maurizio did ask Paolo to make products for Gucci, but they weren't clothes, and they didn't launch at a star-studded fashion show. That part is pure Hollywood embellishment. Maurizio got him to make handbags, and their star-studded debut was at a handbag store. While there were customers present when Paolo was served with a cease and desist, it was very far from a huge fashion event.
And the detail smudging continues. A major plot point of the movie was that Maurizio's inheritance from his father Rodolfo involved some unsigned stock certificates that were later mysteriously signed.
The movie implies that Patrizia was the main suspect, but in real life, the main suspect was Maurizio, accused by Aldo. Maurizio even went through a trial and was acquitted, none of which is in the movie. Rodolfo's longtime assistant maintains that it really was Patrizia who did it, but as it's just a claim, We'll never know for sure. If the film is any indication, married couples should not be working together. But in real life, Ridley Scott works with his wife, Giannina Faccio, and they get along great. He cast her in all his films and is a frequent collaborator and producing partner.
We get along exceptionally well because we are the total opposites as people. We respect each other, and I think that's super important. I mean, what happened with Maurizio and Patrizia is Patrizia didn't respect Maurizio's opinion. So that started that break. We respect each other's opinion. I respect his opinion more than he respects mine, let's say the truth. But he is the master, what can I say?
According to Scott, House of Gucci was a project 20 years in the making, brought to him by his wife Giannina while he was making Gladiator. She acquired the film rights to Sarah Gay Forden's book, and as one of those stories that feels like a movie already, it's not surprising she scooped it up right away.
When I read the book, I fell in love with the story. It was so entertaining, and it had passion, it had love, sex, murder, everything. Fun and fashion, of course, which I love. He loved it as well. There started the journey, looking for the writer. That's where the 20 years passed.
Notable actors who were attached to the film were Angelina Jolie and Leonardo DiCaprio to play Patrizia and Maurizio. Even Margot Robbie was tested to play Lady Gaga's role. Something that you don't really notice, but then once you think about it, makes no sense, is the fact that this is a story that's happening between Italians in Italy who are speaking English, but with an Italian accent. You know, just like they do in Italy. When it comes to realism, sometimes Hollywood takes a few liberties to make sure the emotional connection is readily available to anyone watching. According to Scott,
this is kind of an Italian story, and it can't be a subtitle movie because the subtitle movies are kind of limited in their choice of audiences. This is a big movie.
And the final thing you missed is something that you maybe could just intuit. The Gucci family are not happy about the film, including the Black Widow herself, Patrizia Reggiani. She said in a recent interview, "I'm rather annoyed at the fact that Lady Gaga is playing me in the new Ridley Scott film without having had the consideration and sensibility to come and meet me. It is not an economic question. I won't get a cent from the film. It is a question of good sense and respect." And the Gucci family isn't any happier, telling the Associated Press that they are truly disappointed by the movie. Patrizia Gucci, one of Maurizio's cousins, said of the film, "They are stealing the identity of a family to make a profit, to increase the income of a Hollywood system. Our family has an identity, privacy. We can talk about everything, but there is a borderline that cannot be crossed." The production of the film did not bother to consult the heirs before describing Aldo Gucci, president of the company for 30 years, and the members of the Gucci family as thugs, ignorant, and insensitive to the world around them. They also take issue with the portrayal of Patrizia, with a statement saying she's portrayed not just in the film, but also in statements from cast members as a victim trying to survive in a male and male chauvinist corporate culture. This couldn't be further from the truth. There were several women who held top positions. They go on to cite the fact that the president of Gucci America, the head of global PR and communications, and a member of the board of directors of the Gucci America company were all women. Tom Ford also had some choice words for the film, saying, "I recently survived a screening of the 2-hour and 37-minute film that is House of Gucci. I felt as though I had lived through a hurricane when I left the theater. Was it a farce or a gripping tale of greed? I often laughed out loud, but was I supposed to?" He compared some of the acting in the film to a sketch on Saturday Night Live. At times when Al Pacino as Aldo Gucci and Jared Leto as Aldo's son Paolo Gucci were on the screen, I was not completely sure that I wasn't watching a Saturday Night Live version of the tale. He also said he was deeply sad after watching the film as someone who lived through it. He said it was difficult to see the humor and camp in something that was so bloody. "I suspect it will be a hit. I splash the Gucci name across things and they usually sell." Damn, now there's some double take, was that meant to be mean, level shade. So you know it must come from a fashion designer. And if you had any doubt that the real life story was a lot more dramatic and mean-spirited than what was shown in the film, look no further than these quotes from the family itself. And also the murder. That's also a good sign.